join the Betamax Video Club, rewinding back to our favourite films of the 1980s. My name's Rich Nelson, and today I've rented RoboCop.
Watching it with me is the author, James Montague. Hi, James, how are you?
I'm all right. Thanks for having me on to talk about literally one of my favourite films of all time.
Thank you for bringing your Betamax copy, and this is a sort of a return after your appearance on the Running Man episode, and again, this is one of certainly my top 10 films of all time. What's so special about RoboCop for you?
I think the age that I watched it, I mean, I was quite young when it came out. I think I was probably 9 or 10, and I had older friends, and so I got to see a lot of this kind of illicit, kind of American, highly violent kind of trash, as it was kind of deemed then at the time. I mean, you know, kind of video nasty type kind of videos with just kind of wanton violence and sex. And, you know, at the time, I was just, obviously it was kind of naughty watching it. But then, you know, from a very young age, you start to realise that these are extremely sophisticated movies that have messages which are very intelligent, very prescient, and have become more relevant as time has gone on. And I mean, we'll talk, I'm sure, a little bit later about the director, Paul Verhoeven, because, I mean, he goes through this run, you know, in the 1980s. I mean, Dutch director, known for doing kind of almost kind of award-winning art house period dramas in Holland, in the Netherlands. And then he starts on this run of films where he does kind of RoboCop, Total Recall, Starship Troopers, all three of them extremely political, very smart. In some cases, it took people years to work out that he was saying the opposite of what many people thought the film was about, especially with Starship Troopers. Basic Instinct as well, and then, I mean, he kind of ruins it a bit with Showgirls, but we don't talk about that. But RoboCop is you know, up there with Total Recall as kind of the gem in that collection, and, you know, it returns to a lot of themes that a couple of films, I mean, Running Man, you said we talked about before, obviously from the Stephen King book, but the idea of a future that was kind of owned and run by corporations, where the public space was completely privatized, and the relationship between organized crime and corporate America, which then becomes kind of the corporations of the world. And RoboCop, when you watch it today, it still looks like it's a glimpse of the future, even though much of what it predicted has happened. I mean, obviously we don't have RoboCops yet, although if you look at some of the videos you see online of those dogs, which look like something from Black Mirror, we're not far off them. But in terms of kind of civilians, their relationship to power, you know, it's extraordinarily forward thinking. And it's, you know, watching it back a couple of days ago, it's fresh. It's so fresh still that I could watch it pretty regularly. And I do.
Well, it's good to hear, because I watched it last night, and watching huge parts of it, you think, well, you know, the film was made sort of 33 years ago from the time we're recording this, and so many of the themes are still relevant. There's the idea of big business taking over, and while, you know, perhaps in the UK that's slightly different, but you can imagine in cities throughout the US or other countries where, you know, the police or certain government departments are almost privately contracted, and everything is geared towards corporations and the sort of power vacuums. I mean, there's a whole theme throughout this about they're looking at destroying old Detroit and building a new Delta City, which is going to be the newest, sort of a refresh for the whole city. And it's talking about creating millions of jobs and places to live and work. And all behind this is a scheme to fill that vacuum with drugs, gambling, prostitution, and the sort of criminal element of this are they're designed to exploit that, and even from the top business, they're looking at, right, we're building all these homes, all these offices, all these places that people can live, right, how do we then exploit that through drugs and through everything else? And, you know, again, and the way it kind of weaves in now, that, you know, it doesn't say, I don't think, when this film was actually set. I mean, it's one of those that's probably in the future, but, you know, watching it now, you could still think that could be any future, really, and we're not probably that far away from it. And I think the idea of that, you know, big company, I mean, some conspiracy theorists may say it might be a Facebook or a Google or something, but I mean, OCP are painted as villains from the start, and it's quite interesting to watch now. And certainly when this was made in a similar era to, I don't know, Wall Street or something like that, where greed is good.
I mean, both films have messages, I think, for today. I mean, OCP is the quintessential American corporation, you know, that has its fingers in so many pies, it's diversified. I mean, you know, Ed 209 is the, you know, is Dick Jones's big project to get military contracts. You know, who cares if it doesn't work? You know, it's just, it's so much about, and you said something earlier, like, well, it's not, I'm not sure if it's relevant to Britain, but it's really relevant to Britain. I mean, the way that the public space almost in every area is being sold off, and private security, private military. Look at the way that, say, the Russian state uses the Wagner Group. You know, that we see Blackstone, you know, the almost kind of paramilitary organizations being run in the interests of the state, and much more explicitly than it was done perhaps in the 80s and 90s. But I think I read something the other day about how with RoboCop, that actually it was almost two on the button, that now it does look dated because everything it's predicted has kind of come to pass, you know. And so somewhere, something like Total Recall, which is to me Verhoeven's other great kind of American Hollywood movie, you know, there's still it's a similar kind of dirty dystopic future, almost kind of a Blade Runner style near future that's similar but just dirty, much more technologically advanced, but, you know, it brings its own problems and its own forms of inequality. It's kind of a similar area, but Total Recall has got, you know, a bit more, it's got psychics, it's got mutants, it's got Mars exploration and colony forming. So it is still ahead of us, whereas RoboCop, in a way, is kind of like it has happened. You know, the privatization of the police, privatization of the military, that, you know, the fact that, you know, you do have corporations who, you know, are more powerful and have deeper pockets and more resources than governments in many cases. And so it's you know, it's frightening, but also it's kind of happened. But in terms of the actual film, I mean, you know, there are some just absolute, I mean, as a you know, someone around 10, 12 years old, it was one of the most quotable films that I think I've ever come across. It was just incredible. I can still watch it now, like when Emil gets caught in the kind of sludge tank and he's melting and his face is melting. You know, just such an iconic thing. Imagine how his career must have gone after that, because, like, just, you know, millions of children and young adults around the world will just always imagine him as Emil. But there's, what's great in the casting for this film is that you've also got two, you know, actors playing against type. You know, Dick Jones, you know, the bad guy at OCP, kind of played by Ronnie Cox, who, you know, Beverly Hills Cop, he plays like the good sergeant, the good boss in that, and, you know, he's all sorts of TV roles in the US. He plays, you know, an absolute stone cold bastard in this film, absolutely brilliant, and he does the same when he plays Vilas Cahagan in Total Recall with probably the single best fuck 'em in the history of cinema. You know, and he's so evil, he's so good. And I can't think of any more evil roles that he took after that. But you know, and then, I mean, the other thing to mention in this, of course, is that there still isn't a treatment for baldness in the future, because, you know, you've got Clarence Boddicker, who's kind of played by Kurtwood Smith, who is one of the great Hollywood villains of the 1980s. Absolutely brilliant. Again, another player that gets how much to talk about football, another actor who's kind of playing against type, who's just so dark and so vicious. And obviously, you know, is bald. And this is something that I've noticed in Verhoeven's films. I mean, you've got Michael Ironside as well in Total Recall and Starship Troopers, you know, who's not wearing a wig or had whatever future treatment there is for it. But, you know, that's something you don't see in Hollywood anymore. Unless they're completely clean shaven, you don't see receding baddies anymore, which I think is a loss to the industry.
I wonder if that's a pointed study where he's saying that we can do all these things in the future, but we can't cure male pattern baldness.
Yes, well, you can have a mutant, you can have a psychic mutant living out your belly, but you can't have. We can implant memories of trips to Mars, but you can't grow new hair. So I think there's a message in there somewhere.
I think so, and I mean if you're turning on this film, and I think this is what part of the point of how the film has transcended what a lot of people see as it. I think, you know, I was watching last night, and there are huge parts of the movie where had it been done differently, would have been utterly dreadful. Would have, you know, if it had been in the hands or of someone less skilled, or if it had been written in a slightly different way, it would have just come across as an, I'd say even a B movie would be generous. But you know, the way it opens, you know, well, so I mean, you're talking about a cyborg cop who's going out fighting a crime gang. You know, that's the sort of stuff that goes, I mean, it bypasses straight to DVD. I mean, it goes straight to Channel 5. But you know, the film opens with a TV news broadcast, and they're talking about nuclear war in South Africa and a mishap on the space station where the president's giving an address and the anti-gravity fails. And it's what you expect from 80s TV news, like you see in Batman or Die Hard, where they're all really smiley and glossy and everything's taken with a sense of humour. And it goes straight to an advert for artificial hearts, where the tagline is, "We care."
But
it's just pointing fun right from the off.
It is, and I think that's what elevates RoboCop from, you know, from what could be. I mean, it's a decent script. I mean, Edward Neumeier wrote it, and he also wrote Starship Troopers, he wrote the screenplay, I should say, for Starship Troopers, because it's based on. I mean, there's quite an interesting story about Paul Verhoeven reading the source material for Starship Troopers, which was a kind of war biography by a kind of extremely sadistic marine trainer, and he was so disgusted by how fascistic it was that he threw the book across the room, and it was his wife that picked it back up and said, actually, there's something you could almost parody here, and he went back to it. So, you know, but in both those cases, you know, I mean, I think with RoboCop, Neumeier, it was kind of his idea, but it could very easily have turned into kind of B-movie, straight to Betamax, not VHS, straight to Betamax affair. But what elevates it is Paul Verhoeven, and the fact that he brings, you know, almost, you know, this very cynical outside eye, experiencing American culture for the first time. This is kind of lampooning 80s American culture, having adverts, having, you know, private healthcare where you're buying, you know, it's, you know, hearts for the highest bidders, where these corporations are making motorbikes and cars and hearts, you know, that you know, everything is commodified and everything's for sale at the highest price. And those adverts, you know, again, it also builds a kind of new world, like the news broadcasts, which have the adverts in the middle of them with the Newcomb game, which is something you saw again. We talked about Running Man. I mean, it's something that they did, you know, Climbing for Dollars, you know, which was, you know, one day I'm sure we're going to see some kind of like Climbing for Dollars kind of game show somewhere, you know, on American television. But yeah, it was this kind of building this new universe of news, which is kind of, it's not so fantastical, but it's just conflicts in new areas. You know, nuclear war in South America. The fact that one of the space stations goes wrong and sets fire to much of California, where former President Gerald Ford is killed or something. But the former president is killed, and the nation's in mourning, and they have this, you know, literally like maybe a 1 second beat in mourning, and then they're straight back into the news. So the universe that he very cleverly sets out at the beginning, and the lamp and the kind of satire, which is again something that he goes back to with Starship Troopers, or kind of expands on in Starship Troopers, is absolutely pivotal in setting up the film for what it is, which is, you know, very caustic, very intelligent look at the direction that the world, and especially America, is going in. I think Verhoeven to a Western, like an English speaking audience, was almost seen as a kind of, you know, a voyeur, somebody who used sex and violence to, you know, in a kind of very degrading Hollywood way. But again, it was his outside status that made him, I think, the best person to build these films and these universes. And It's what elevates it, I think, to, you know, above cult status in a way. I think this is something that really has. I was really surprised actually seeing that a couple of reviews at the time actually in the States kind of really picked up on some of these themes as well. So it is I think in terms of action movies of the 1980s, if you call it an action movie, probably in the top five of films that have, you know, that today are as fresh, or almost as fresh, if not more so than the day they were released.
Everything about it, watching it now, and this is the thing where, you know, it's easy to watch films now and look at how dated they are. But I mean, even the special effects in this, that yes, they use a lot of stop motion rather than CGI, and that's probably a good thing. Bear in mind some of how CGI's aged. Although even looking at the recent sort of Star Wars films and that, you kind of wonder that maybe CGI isn't that great. Mm. But you know, again, it's easy to think that, you know, this is a futuristic sci-fi element to this, but a lot of it isn't about that. There are, you know, the plot, I mean, the opening, the entrance, and the introduction to Ed 209 in the OCP boardroom, I mean, it's very much a pastiche of corporate boardrooms, and where an executive, a young, presumably quite up and coming executive, is murdered by a sort of errant robot, and the boss, the big boss, who's only ever referred to as the old man, just said, "I'm very disappointed." You know, just, you know, this guy's body is lying there on a small model of this Delta City. The blood squibs are still smoking, the smoke coming out of the guns of the machine. And yet, you know, it's all just, oh, this is terrible. The executives are then already jockeying for position and who's going to exploit the gap. And this contract is obviously not going to be fulfilled. And Morton, who's this sort of lickspittle, toady, nasty little guy, obviously seeks the opportunity and jumps in. But this is one scene where I remember watching this the first time on video, and I would have been, again, like yourself, 9 or 10, thinking, oh my God, that's incredible, you know, watching all this blood. And then I watched, because I got, there's a new DVD release or Blu-ray release of the film where they have side by side the version that was out at cinemas and then the director's cut. And you compare the cuts, and there's, you know, there's just so much more blood in the director's cut. I mean, in his vision of the film, it's just blood, 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 squib, squib, bullet, bullet. And watching it then, and you think, I thought there was I thought there was a lot of blood in the original one. And watching it like that is just astounding, because it's amazing how much money went on blood.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, you're right with when it comes to special effects. I mean, the whole thing is beautifully shot. And I think that, you know, much of it isn't shot in Detroit. It's a little bit like if you watch A Clockwork Orange now, you know, it still feels weirdly futuristic. I think it was in the South Bank a lot of it was filmed, which is, had only recently just been finished. And I think that was the same with where they would, I think they filmed it in Houston. You know, it has something of that, you know, kind of like a timeless dystopic air to it. But a lot of the special effects, the suit still looks absolutely incredible. And it's funny thinking about that suit, because it is one of the most iconic, you know, special effects moments in cinema of the past kind of 40 years, having this kind of RoboCop character, which kind of, I mean, Peter Weller ended up effectively getting the job, because he could fit in it and could operate it, you know, and also because he, you know, having half your face obscured made it quite difficult to, you know, emote and express anything. And he didn't want to be too, you know, too robotic, because the point of it is the melding of man and machine, you know, kind of human flesh and bone with kind of artificial intelligence to make, you know, which is, again, human augmentation is another issue that it was ahead of its time on. But yeah, the suit still, there's only a couple of times. I mean, to be honest, the Ed 209 is, I mean, it's amazing. The gunshots are, you know, the pounding of the executive is pretty impressive. I mean, you can tell that the effects have aged a bit badly on that. And the only other moment is when RoboCop gets the gun out and spins it, and it looks like he's kind of it looks like he's winding up a clock or something, you know. But apart from that, it's remarable how, even down to there's just so many lovely little touches in it, like the vox pops that the news do. Mm. And there's that character, Kevin Rosenberg, who comes up his name. I mean, I'm gonna I'm going to use that name as a fake name if I ever have to use one, you know, who's obviously stoned out of his mind. It's just, there's no reason to have him in there. But it's just this brilliant moment of comedy.
It's a free society. Except there ain't nothing free because there's no guarantees, you know. You're on your own. There's a lot of jungle.
And, you know, but yeah, if everything about it feels the music. I mean, even when they go to that nightclub and you know, when Robocop has that reawakening and he decides to go and catch the men that could have initially killed Murphy, who he was before Robocop was Robocop. And he goes in and he finds Leon Nash in a nightclub and drags him out by his hair. But that, I mean, I remember trying to track down that song later on, and it's brilliant, by a band called PC. I think it's called I Want Your Spine. And it's like a super group from Ministry and some other, like, Skinny Puppy, I think it is. But, like, you couldn't get it for years. And it's an absolutely brilliant song, you know, and it holds up today. So everything, I mean, you know, the design of the cars, the design of the body armour, you know, it was beautifully built. It was a beautifully built film. And, you know, it's a shame it couldn't really, it did spawn a franchise, but nothing ever came close to that. And I think, again, that's you know, you have to look at the director as, I think, probably the reason for that.
There were two sort of main sequels. There was a cartoon, I think there was a TV series, and then there was the reboot of maybe 5 or 6 years ago, yeah. Which was a bit of again, they tried to cast a lot of the supporting cast, you know, there were people like, I think Michael Keaton was one of them, and it didn't work. I think it kind of missed the, it had all everything in place, but it lacked the humour and it lacked the kind of, it lacked a lot of the authenticity,
it lacked intelligence, that's what it was. Ooh. Just the, you know, by numbers Hollywood action flick, and it was what would have happened in 1986. If Paul Verhoeven wasn't directing that film, it would have been that film and it would have disappeared without trace, and it would not have had the same cultural impact that it still does today.
They've obviously tried to. And I mean, even I watched Robocop 2 maybe 6 months ago, and Robocop 2 isn't bad. And that's about as complimentary as I can be about any of the other Robocop films. It's amusing and it's fairly close in tone to the original, but it just isn't, it's not as good.
When I got my first library card where I didn't have to go with my mum and dad, Robocop 2 was the first book I got out. So I guess that's the first book. I mean, I read a lot when I was, when I was at primary school age, reading club and stuff, but this was like, here's your card, you can go to the library on your own. And what's the first thing I do unsupervised? I get Robocop 2, the novel, out.
Was it any good?
I mean, at the time, I thought it was amazing, but it was just, I mean, essentially, it's about a 12-year-old kid who's a drug lord who gets gunned down and turned into a robot. So, I mean, to a 12-year-old kid, that sounds fucking brilliant, doesn't it?
That's the dream. I mean, in this film, and one of the scenes that I always remember, even in some ways makes you flinch a little bit, is the scene where Murphy is killed. The whole essence that he's met his new partner, Lewis, who, I mean, a lot of people remember either from, I know, Grease or Carrie, Nancy Allen. And their partner, then their first call is essentially Clarence Boddicker and his gang have got these crates of money. They're in their van driving off. And I know it's deliberate, you know, they say they can't outrun the cop car, so it's the slowest chase you'll ever see. And it's just full of iconic parts, though. They've got, you know, one of their gang members is wounded. And, you know, we're, 15 minutes into the film, and it shows how, you know, wicked Clarence is, because rather than, you know, look after this guy, he goes, can you fly, Bobby? And they has him thrown into the windscreen of the cop car.
My leg!
Oh, man! Pick him up.
Ready?
No, hang on.
Bobby!
Can you fly, Bobby?
Clarence, no!
Hit it!
No! I mean, it just shows, you know, and everything from there, and they make it to the steel mill, which becomes almost like the sort of recurring set piece place for them. It's, I mean, the way that Murphy gets kind of cornered, and it's just, it's hard watching now. I mean, it's great and it's really well done, but bloody hell.
Yeah, I mean, Nancy Allen is absolutely superb in that film. There's obviously a connection between her and Peter Weller in their actors playing those roles. So immediately there's a kind of like distrust. But one of the things that's what's interesting about this kind of futuristic police department that's about to be privatized is the role of women and men within it. You often see this, and actually it's again a theme that comes up in Starship Troopers, that you have men fighting against women, that they're all together in the, and it's something that comes up in Aliens as well, that men and women are treated as equals within the police force, within security, within the army, within the special forces, and they're treated as equals and they change together. There's nudity, but there's nothing sexualized about it. They are considered equals and have an equal role to play. And I thought that was quite an interesting thing that's got picked up on quite a few of the same films from the age. And, you know, Nancy Allen as well, that when she comes back and recognizes that there's something of Murphy who's still there, her role is absolutely fundamental in still keeping that human root to the film, because that is ultimately, you know, there's all the other great stuff that's very political and satirical. But ultimately it is about, we could do this, but should we do this? And what would be the kind of human consequences of those actions? And that, she roots that. She brings that back down to all the way to the end of the movie. To the end of the film, and really roots it still in that concept. And I think it's absolutely vital for it to, again, not be something which is, you know, it is an extremely gory film. It's a very violent film. It's a very dark film. There's not much light in it. And she helps kind of root that in somewhere much more human.
The part where, because initially she's knocked out after getting the guy to zip up his trousers, so Murphy gets cornered on his own by the gang, and she has to watch helplessly him getting gunned down in all its gory detail, because I mean there's one, she's stuck in there, but two, you know, she knows that if she goes out there she's going to meet the same fate. And the way that, I mean, bear in mind, as far as the film goes, they've only just met, you know, this is their first shift together, and you know, she's, again, their colleagues, it's that thin blue line thing where, you know, he's died on the job and she's cradling him and everything. But, you know, the way that she portrays, you know, she comes across, she's blowing bubble gum in, you know, it pops, and she's kicking the guy's ass in the custody area of the police station. You know, she's not just there as kind of window dressing or anything. And picking up on one of the points you made earlier about the male and female sort of officers changing in the same room, that was something else that was pointed out on the Blu-ray, was when the film was cut for TV, they CGI'd a bra onto the one pair of bare breasts you can see, just because it's fine to have all the violence and all the swearing. Well, actually some of the swearing was creatively cut as well, but it's almost like they pointed it out in South Park. It's like you can have all this violence, but you can't use any naughty words. And they even edited out the word scumbag to crumbag. Watching that bit last night made me giggle. I mean, some of the way they visualised Murphy being killed, or well, we say killed. You know, the special effects were done by Rob Bottin, who did a lot of the special effects for The Thing. You know, this is the kind of era we are when, and we talked about on The Thing episode we did quite recently, where those special effects in that movie were far ahead of their time. And the effects with Murphy losing his limbs and,
oh, when he had his hand blown off, that's, I mean, it still looks. You know, that still makes you wince. I mean, The Thing, I mean, I actually watched The Thing for the first time under lockdown. I watched it with my dad, because my dad had a, he's still around. So he really, one of the reasons why I mean, he didn't show me RoboCop, because that wasn't really to his taste. But in terms of kind of horror movies, kind of 70s and early 80s sci-fi horror movies, things like, you know, Soylent Green and the Andromeda Strain, things like that, you know, he was very, you know, Capricorn 1, all those movies, he's very much into, you know, sitting me down as quite a young, probably too young, and watch those. And Quatermass, going back a bit later as well. You know, Twilight Zone, the original black and white ones. I mean, so we spent a lot of time watching those movies, and we'd never watched a thing before. and we sat down and watched it. And it is, I mean, I found the monster a bit too confusing, to be honest. But you can tell that it's a wonderful piece of kind of engineering for the time. You know, but it's almost Carpenter's kind of direction and shooting of it, because it's the environment and the bleakness of it and the tension and the psychology of it that's just, that again, elevates that film out of something. But you could, the special effects for RoboCop were just, the sound of gunfire. I mean, I'm not sure if I've can actually, I don't think I've ever heard somebody getting machine gunned down. But I imagine it sounds a lot like what Ed 209 sounds like when he's when he's pumping bullets into the poor executive over Delta City.
You didn't come across that on any of your many travels across the globe.
And that, well, not a kind of bastard robot that could fire kind of 400 rounds a second. No, I didn't.
Not in a boardroom.
In a boardroom. I mean, I've heard plenty of gunfire, but kind of close range bullet into flesh, I've not, thankfully, been aware of that.
Not a good way to go. And you do wonder if the chairman of the board was so, well, that's disappointing. You wonder what the compensation package to his family would have been. Okay, that's another film, I think. Now, I mean, we go into the whole scene where Murphy's being put together, basically, into RoboCop, and there's all this stuff about being unveiled as, you know, the ultimate crime-fighting machine, where we see, and it kind of works nicely as exposition, the prime directives come up on his sort of on-screen display of the serve public trust, protect the innocent, uphold the law, and the mystical fourth directive, which sounds like something out of a Frederick Forsyth novel. But as you mentioned, Lewis sees him on the shooting range when everyone sees this guy holding this mini cannon, and the way he spins the gun, you know, it's because he happens to have mentioned earlier when he was doing it as Murphy that it was his kid's favourite TV show, and he was spinning it like, was it TJ Laser, I think it was
called. Yeah, yeah.
So like TJ Hooker. I suppose it's the equivalent of me spinning an Eagle Piggle around and shoving it in my pocket. But I mean, it's just things like that where, you know, we've seen this is him looking different. But people, I mean, the cops, I think, generally recognise him as, my God, you know, this is great. You know, this guy's one of us. And immediately, it's almost like when in the Superman movie, when early on he starts, not showing off, but we start seeing his range of abilities. Mm. We've got the convenience store robbery with a guy holding up the old couple, which I think was probably the same convenience store in Teen Wolf, and he manages to bend the gun and throws the guy into a freezer. And again, this is something, whenever you mention RoboCop on social media, people will always come back with, I'll buy that for a dollar. Yeah. And this is the guy in the background who's, I suppose, the closest thing we have to Benny Hill.
I'd buy that for a dollar.
With, you know, a little old guy balding again with glasses with two blonde women, and I'd buy that for a dollar.
I'm pretty sure that he turns up, or I don't know if they just, do you remember the computer game Smash TV?
Yeah.
Pretty sure that he comes up in that. I'm sure it's a whole game basically built on the universe of this mythical,
I'd buy that for a dollar.
Which Emil, by the way, the guy who is melted in the toxic sludge later on, absolutely loves, and he's laughing his bollocks off. And it's just so unfunny. It's just terminally unfunny. But yeah, you're right. You see these kind of, like, he goes through the range of emotion. And he kind of, you see that he's obviously impenetrable to bullets. He stops a rape by shooting one of the punks in the bollocks as well. Mm. So it shows that he's got very good aim. And, you know, and then later on, he manages to apprehend Emil, who sets fire to a petrol station. So you see the full kind of range of emotions. But, you know, again, like in Superman, you also see, you know, what his weakness is. Partly, you know, there is a physical limit to what, you know, even a RoboCop could do. But it is this extra directive that, again, is put in by Dick Jones. And it's, again, it shows the kind of power of the corporations. For me, I mean, of course, I've just written a book called 1312, and we were talking earlier about the police and the police, you know, policing in general is a kind of, you know, is a hugely emotive issue around the world, in the UK, but especially in the US. But what's interesting is that this is a really sympathetic film to the police, I think, you know, that there is a, you know, crime is out of control. partly because corporations have jumped into bed with the criminal underworld because they both share some similar interests and goals. And ordinary people's lives are destroyed because of that. And the police are expected as underfunded and under-invested to kind of to try to somehow deal with that, and they can't. And that's used then as a reason to kind of privatise and bring in corporations who could kind of take, you know, alleviate the pressure. And you see, you feel enormous sympathy immediately. I mean, there's that scene when Murphy turns up at the police station at the front desk, you know, and then one of their colleagues had recently been gunned down, and you have that moment where the sergeant comes in and takes his nameplate off of the locker. You know, another one down, another, you know, that they're getting creamed out there. And so, you know, RoboCop is, you know, he's a product of the same forces which have undermined the police force. But yeah, there is an understanding that, you know, this guy could turn the tables like he does with the guy who works from the mayor's office when he just punches through the wall and drags him through. I've never understood what does he say. He wants a car, he wants cruise control, and he wants a Blaupunkt. I don't know what that is. What is it?
The Blaupunkt. It was an old make of car stereo.
Right. Okay. So, but they just mangle it. The German.
The American pronunciation. Yeah.
For years, I was wondering what's that. What's he asking for? Is that some kind of like future thing that we're going to discover in 10 years' time as being in development? Yeah.
Because my dad had a Blaupunkt in one of his cars, and I always thought, oh wow, you know, that must be the elite if someone who's holding the mayor hostage asks for one as part of the contract. But I mean, even that, you know, that there's that whole consumerism element within a hostage negotiation where he asks for a car with shitty mileage, and they offer him, was it the 6000 SUX?
Yeah.
Or 6000 sucks. And then that's the car that the criminals get when they come into a bit of money and when they get given stuff, you know. And we see an advert for it as well. And it's weird. Like I was talking about when, you know, my wife declined the opportunity to watch this film last night when I sat down. But she walked in during the advert for the 6000 SUX, and it was a dinosaur. Do you remember the old Chewitz advert?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was just like that, wasn't it? And this dinosaur sort of walking along and stomping this city, and then all of a sudden stops to look at this poster for this car.
It's back. Big is back, because bigger is better. 6000 SUX, an American tradition.
And it's fantastic because you think, you know, bear in mind Detroit is Motor City and everything else. Everyone idolises this car because it has really bad miles per gallon. But in the current day, you'd end up paying a congestion charge and a low emission zone charge for something with shitty mileage. So, I don't know, you don't really think about that anymore.
No. I mean, I can't drive. So, well, I can drive. I don't have a licence. So, so for someone who has very much the idea of what a car should look like in kind of a teenage brain, you know, the SUX 6000 looked like a pretty damn good car to me.
I consider that when I was, I ended up opting for a Skoda. But what can I say? Now, as you said, you know, he apprehends Emil. And I didn't realise, and again, there's something my wife pointed out, that the actor playing Emil had been in Fame. I mean, he's obviously, you know, well, he's not being typecast in any way. Now, he's apprehended after essentially getting free diesel or free petrol for his motorbike, and RoboCop turns up. And this is where his cyborg thing, where he can record video and conversations, because he records Emil saying, "We killed you." And it's this really cool bit where he goes into the sort of computer archive at the police station, gets his big spike out, goes into the main computer and starts downloading all the information about Emil's accomplices. It's just fantastic the way, like you say, he goes into the nightclub because he's starting to get these flashbacks. You know, he's already had the dream where he remembers things, and he starts visualizing. He goes to where his family or where he used to live, and the house is now empty, and there's the sort of precursor for a Johnny Cab acting as an estate agent. It's almost like, right, he's now transitioning back towards Murphy. And the whole thing in the nightclub's fantastic. I mean, Leon is just this... I mean, to describe him as a shit is just putting it politely, but the way he nicks him out of this nightclub's amazing.
Yeah, I mean, and that's where PCP comes in, the incredible song, which I think it probably, I'm trying to think of like top, probably the song from Silence of the Lambs when he's wearing the human suit.
Oh, yeah.
that and PCP, you know, I mean, you could make a really dark compilation of movies, movies out, songs from that. Yeah, I mean, from there, you know, the human then kind of overtakes the, you know, overtakes the kind of technology, and it's that constant battle between man and machine. And then ultimately, I mean, again, it shows that, you know, when he apprehends Clarence Bodiger, who's just, it's just one of the great baddies, you know, Kurt Smith, just brilliant. But just shows how untouchable he is. You know, he's out. He's got all that recorded and he's out back on the streets. And, you know, again, you know, when it comes to kind of reflecting the legal system, that is what we see. You know, it's the justice you can afford, not the justice that you deserve in many cases. And then it takes it all the way back to the steel mill for this, you know, incredible climax where you have, well, I mean, do we give away? Is it? I mean, I guess we can give away spoilers, right? I mean,
I'd like to think if anyone is listening to the podcast, they've probably seen the film.
I think so, but you never know. I mean,
yeah, true. People listen to UHF, and I don't think they'd seen it before. So, I mean, that's what I say. I mean, you say about the justice you can afford. I mean, bear in mind that, and this is going to sound really technical and not very film at all. Well, actually, the person who was responsible for the revamping of the Bail Act in the UK quite recently was Paul Gambaccini. So. Yeah, well, sorry, that's how weird things are.
Not the Paul Gambaccini.
Paul Gambaccini, the one who used to, the music kind of guy.
Really?
Yeah.
What's he doing that for?
There was an issue where I think he or one of his friends was suspected of some historic offences.
Oh, was he? Was he Utrecht? Was he?
I believe so, or around that time.
Allegedly,
and there were some issues.
Falsely Utrecht.
Yes.
Before we get that in there, I think
Utrecht is a verb, and. He basically was, his bail was renewed so many times that I think he went through court. It's in the way that Harry Redknapp was responsible for, there was some rewording around what applying for search warrants. But Paul Gambaccini, basically when they revamped the Bail Act, you can only be on bail now for a certain period of time.
Right.
Because of Paul Gambaccini. Right. So
I'm just checking out what Emil got up to after Robocop. I can't remember seeing him in anything. But apparently he won a Screen Actors Guild Award for, he was in ER for 11 years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and he won an Emmy in 2011. How did I not know any of this? I only think of him as the kind of help me, I'm melting guy from Robocop. But it turns out, yeah, he blossomed afterwards.
I think it's like something of playing Frankenstein's monster. But, one thing I read about Kurtwood Smith playing Bodica, and again, the whole wonderful scene where Morton is doing cocaine with the two women, and Bodiger walks in licking the pin out of the hand grenade and saying,
"Bitches leave."
When he plays,
that was the playground line that, you know, that came out of Robocop pretty much, you know. And I mean, it's an odd, yeah. I mean, he all that money, I mean, you know, and he's got these two pretty ropey, you know, cool girls yeah. in there, and you know. Sniffing the cocaine, and then Bodiger comes in, puts in the DVD, I guess, or it might be Blu-ray technology, I don't know, and it has, you know, Dick Jones on there, kind of, you know, killing his, I mean, you just fucked with the wrong guy when he kind of pulls his hair in the executive washroom after he overhears him speaking, which is, little do we know that's him signing his own death warrant. But yeah, it's like you mentioned earlier, like the fact that it kind of really shows the absolute immorality of corporations at the very top, where murder and, you know, you've just got to be completely amoral to get there. And that's how you get rid of the competition. You basically kill it. And yeah, it's a bit weirdly, a kind of, even though he was probably an amoral psychopath, I quite liked Bob Morton. You know, I thought, you know, he was quick. He had a bit of humour about him, but
yeah, he's just not quite evil enough. The old sort of nasty cocaine arsehole, but he wasn't a murderer. And
he
that's
wasn't
what
as
cost
bad
him
as Ronnie Cox. I mean, Ronnie Cox, like the Dick Jones, was absolutely, you know, brilliant. And I mean, him and Cohagen are two of my favourite baddies of the era. Yeah. I mean, actually, I wouldn't say of the 80s, because I think Total Recall came out in 91 or 1990.
It was 90.
Yeah. So does that not qualify for this show?
Well, the weird thing is that it was set in the 2080s, because I had to look this up, and I thought, well, I could use that as an excuse to do an episode on that. So, yeah, why not?
Well, we can freely talk about, you know, it's your podcast, man. You can do whatever you like. But, I mean,
exactly.
This is, you know, I think that we talked about it a little bit earlier about Paul Verhoeven, but this, you know, I see that those three films are really connected to each other in terms of the themes and the violence and the fact that people saw something and it was actually the opposite of what they saw. You know, I see RoboCop, Total Recall and Starship Troopers all in the same category, almost like his trilogy, you know, almost his Godfather, you know, but they're, you know, and you see many of the same actors in there, you see many of the same type of characters in there. I mean, actually, I read somewhere that Michael Ironside was supposed to play RoboCop, which would have been pretty interesting, because again, he's in Total Recall, he's Richter, which is welcome to the party, Richter, when he rips his arms off. I always think that that'll be one of the great Hollywood kind of props to have in your house. Richter's arms, have those up on your wall somewhere, you know. Have the whole thing. You could have Gwyneth Paltrow's head from Seven. You could have Richter's arms up there, you know. And those three films, I rewatched Starship Troopers again the other day, and I mean, it's actually quite a hard watch, because I couldn't believe rewatching it how people could have completely mistook it as a kind of gung ho kind of jock war movie when it is one of the most anti-fascist kind of movies. You've even got Doogie Howser MD. What's his real name?
Neil Patrick Harris.
Neil Patrick Harris. You know, he's literally dressed in an SS uniform at the end. Yeah. it's amazing that people could have somehow got the wrong end of the stick with that, you know. And it was just so, again, you know, mixing media obsession with celebrity, you know, kind of hyper commercialization into a kind of dystopic future, which is brighter and cleaner, you know, in the far future in Starship Troopers, but it's still. I mean, they've obviously had the massive war, the civil war that almost killed everybody. But yeah, it's less grimy, but it's no less morally grimy, I think. And that's, you know, those three films should all be watched together.
And when you see that one of the IMDb trivia bits was that Kurtwood Smith based his portrayal of Boddicke on Himmler, it probably says a lot as well. So,
well, he's got the glasses.
I think that was the idea. He said he looked more menacing in that way because he said, well, They didn't want Boddicke to be this kind of just large guy that could be outsmarted. They wanted him to look kind of threatening and probably more intelligent, so they gave him the glasses, which, again, it's just one of those things where give a guy glasses, he suddenly becomes a brainiac.
Yeah.
So Boddicke's arrested, and it's the whole...
Just give me my fucking phone call.
...thing. He's out. He goes straight to Dick Jones, who essentially is saying, like, this is where he says that, you know, the vacuum of all these workers, all these people living in Delta City, we need to give them drugs and gambling and prostitution, but they need to get rid of RoboCop. So he arms Boddicke and his guys with these military weapons to give him a tracker for RoboCop, so they know exactly where he is. And we get the amusing scene of them kind of, I'll say looting, but destroying this little strip of shops and nude bars and TV rental places with their massive guns. And it all kind of leads to that showdown where it is the tracker saying, oh, he's at the old steel mill, because that's where Murphy's recovering after his showdown with Ed 209, because as he's gone to arrest Dick Jones, because he's got the footage of Boddicke basically bubbling him up, saying he's responsible. Ed 209 and his ultimate weakness of stairs. You know, it's not a young executive can't bring him down, RoboCop can't bring him down, but he can't go down a flight of stairs.
I mean, it is quite a significant design fault, really. Just because all you'd have to do as a guerrilla force anywhere in the world taking on the US military is just make sure you fight your battles where there's lots of stairs. And Ed 209 is completely fucked, can't walk up it, can't go down them. And then it makes it kind of, there's a bit when he falls down the stairs as well, he's kind of on his back, like thrashing around like a tortoise. He's making kind of like a whining sound that kind of can almost make you feel a bit sorry for him, you know, or her. I mean, Ed 209. Well, I suppose Ed 209 is sexless, or I suppose Ed, although it's, yeah, you know.
But then he's they sound like alien, like when the alien was being hurt, or yeah, yeah. I don't know if he's portrayed as being a dog or something, but he's making these like growling sounds that become really whiny, like when my dog's a bit hungry, he starts making those sounds. But you know, that's the thing. I guess that's why you don't see many cows as police officers either. You know, they can't go up and downstairs.
But then, yeah, then it takes us to the conclusion of the film, which is, well, not, well, actually, not the conclusion of the film. I mean, there's one more scene to go, but the, you know, where the bad guys really bite the dust in the most horrific method. I mean,
yeah,
you know, Robocop's almost killed when Leon drops a load of you know, metal girders on him, but then he's instantaneously blown up by Nancy Allen's character. Emil gets dissolved in acid and then run over, where he's destroyed, and his head then bounces over the police car. And then, you know, you've got Clarence Boddicker, who's, you know, they're having the fighting showdown, and you see the same spike that Robocop has on his hand that he uses to access data, that he just sticks that in his neck, which, and then gives you the best kind of, the very best of the favourite 1980s method of execution, which is some form of neck injury that makes like arterial blood squirt like about 4 or 5 metres, and that's how Boddicker goes, like squirting his way down. You know, there's also, I remember a fantastic death in Total Recall that I think it's when Arnie kind of comes to, or Hauser, he comes to, and he managed to take his hand out of the chair at Total Recall, Recall Corporation.
Yeah.
And he puts the bolt in the side of the guy's neck, and he goes off and squirting arterial blood everywhere. And then the other guy's just kind of like boffin guy who looks like he looks a little bit like the guy who's on TV every day in Great Britain giving advice about COVID, you know, the chief medical officer.
Yeah.
And he gets a kind of like, almost like a camera tripod, and kind of like shoves it into his nose and through the back of his skull. And just see him. Oh, I just think he's probably just there doing the science. You know, he's probably the geek, and he just literally impaled the poor guy's head. You know, he's just in the wrong place at the wrong time. Yeah, so you have these series of very gruesome deaths at the end of Robocop, and then the showdown, which has at the end of it, you know, just such a wonderful plot device where they go back to the boardroom. And the old man is there, and Dick Jones is there giving his kind of, you know, giving his spiel. And then Robocop comes in.
I mean, it's fantastic the way that, you know, they say, oh, we've got Ed 209s everywhere. We've got one guarding the building. And Robocop just has one of these military guns and just takes them, blows him up and goes up in the lift. And, you know, we've got this plot device where, you know, Robocop is aware that if he arrests an executive of OCP, he'll be shut down. So, you know, while he confronts, he shows the board the evidence of Dick Jones confessing to killing Morton and everything else that he's done, he immediately takes the old man as hostage, and, you know, knowing full well that the only thing stopping him from doing anything about Dick Jones is that he's still an employee of OCP, the old man fires him, and the way that the directive on the screen just disintegrates, like, right, doesn't apply anymore, carry on.
Yeah, Dick, you're fired. And he thanks him and shoots him, and he goes flying out the window. And again, this is even going back to kind of Indiana Jones, almost any film. Let's think of The Untouchables. The great failing of 1980s movie was sufficiently filming or getting the special effects right of people being thrown out of buildings and seeing their face go down. They always look terrible.
They can't all be diehard.
No.
Anybody tries to stop me, the old geezer gets it. Dick, you're fired!
Thank you.
I'm just trying to. I've got the internet in front of me. I'm trying to find one of the because we were talking about Ed 209, and Ed 209, obviously the worst law enforcement droid in the history of law enforcement droids. Yeah. you know, literally, I think the only person it does kill in the end is that poor assistant when it goes haywire because it's not done properly. But I always remember there was an Ed 209, 10 seconds to comply. Happy. I was really into happy hardcore when I was a kid.
And okay.
So if anybody listening to this can find who, it might have been Slipmat or it was some happy hardcore DJ from the early 90s had an Ed called 10 seconds to comply. It was an absolute banger.
That rings a bell, actually.
Never, yeah. I mean, can't find it.
I'm sure that's because I've heard that in popular culture elsewhere, and I wonder if that maybe I'd come across that at some point. I mean, surely it wouldn't be lurking on Spotify somewhere.
Mm. 20 seconds to comply! 20 seconds to comply! 20 seconds to comply! I mean, I managed to track down PCP eventually, so I should be able to find this one.
Robocop, you know, he doesn't arrest Dick Jones, he just shoots him and chucks him out the window. When the old man says, "Oh, nice shooting, what's your name?" and he says, "Murphy," you know, that's where it's like, oh, right, okay, yeah. He's Murphy now, he's not Robocop anymore.
Well, that's
he's
it.
He's almost like Murphy plus.
Yeah, that's the, you know, he's had this journey and he becomes, you know. And, you know, the other thing is that the old man, as much as clearly he's an evil piece of shit because he's the head of this corporation where he's thinking, good, okay, well, we can sell these products to the military. He's absolutely fine. You know, he's obviously, you know, an amoral psychopath as well. But again, he always comes across as a very kindly, almost, you know, quite a nice character. Almost like he doesn't really know what's going on. You know, that he thinks that he's in charge of a sweet factory when in fact, you know, he's making this kind of, these weapons of brutality.
That would have made Willy Wonka very different, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would have done, you know. And then, you know, but then the journey is complete.
Dead or alive, you are coming with me.
I know you. You're dead. We killed you!
Well, James, thank you for coming back. Now, after the last episode, we talked about your previous book, The Billionaire's Club. Now, your new book that has come out quite recently, 1312, you want to tell us a little bit about that, please?
Yeah, it's a book about the ultra movement around the world, which has been a constant theme in many of my books because they're so secretive. They're ubiquitous. I mean, they're in every country almost where you find football, but very, very much don't like authority, don't like journalists, don't like the police, and yet they are, you know, or were until COVID, absolutely essential in moulding a subculture around football that kind of gave much of its aesthetics and much of its sound, the song, the atmosphere. One of the most, and we've noticed this with empty stadiums, one of the most sellable aspects of what football is as well, as a product, as an entertainment product. And it's just this incredible subculture, and I wanted to kind of document it as best I could. And it took me years, you know, really to try and get access to a lot of groups because they're very suspicious of authority, and that's why the book was called 1312, because it's an acronym it's a number code for the acronym ACAB, All Cops Are Bastards, because you know, although
we are
a lot of them look similar in terms of how ultras, you know, there's a kind of uniformity that is based very much on what's kind of a mixture of kind of English casual, Italian ultra, and, you know, Argentine Barras Bravas and also the Torcida from Brazil kind of mixed together. But there is also a attitude, one of living an outsider kind of life and being in opposition in all times to the police and to authorities. And so that was this number code I would see spray painted almost every city I went to. And I was living in Belgrade until very recently, and you just saw 1312 absolutely everywhere. And so when I thought about writing this book, I thought I'll put that on, that's the cover I want. And I thought I might be a bit controversial, but the publisher were great with it. They went with it. And then, of course, what's happened now with the protests in the US is that I'm getting messages almost every day from people at protests in the US taking pictures, because 1312 is now has become a kind of that, and ACAB has become, you know, very well known in the US. It was kind of very minority word that was used in the punk scene, used in the kind of underworld, used in the kind of football scene. But now it means something that, that, you know, Black Lives Matter activists are using because, you know, it's for them against the police. So, yeah, it's kind of, it took a couple of years to write it. And I mean, to be honest, what's everything that's happened with COVID since, you know, it came out a week before pretty much the proper shutdown in the UK in March. And, you know, it's looking back at it, like, I can't believe the kind of travel I had to do and the kind of experiences I had to write this book, because I don't think I'm ever going to be able to, or anyone will ever be able to travel in that way again. It's kind of a monument to the kind of freedom I had for the past 2 years. And I don't think I'll ever get that freedom back, or certainly not for a long, long time. I thought the world might be changed permanently because of COVID. And on the one hand, it makes me very proud of it. On the other hand, it makes me quite sad that's probably the last book of its type I'm going to write.
And it's difficult. I mean, it's on my wish list to read. And it's, again, what we're seeing now. I mean, we talked about the whole era of police and cops in talking about the film. But when you see about, I think we kind of first got talking because I do some bits about football in Finland. And there was one of the clubs over there on their season tickets 1 year had dice on the card. And it had 1-3, 1-2 on the dice on the season ticket. And all these things where, I mean, ACAB, I think that was in the Viz Profanosaurus as well at one point. But yeah, it's such a common thing now in the UK.
One of the things is that, of course, ACAB, you know, I mean, it comes from Britain. All coppers are bastards. But it has, because over the time it has become kind of criminalised. I mean, I think it's even considered a hate speech in the US by the Anti-Defamation League. But the what's interesting is that, because 1-3, because then of course people getting arrested for wearing ACAB t-shirts or having ACAB tattoos or using it, you know, flaunting in front of the police. And 1-3-1-2 comes out of the fact that then, okay, we need to change that up. We need to hide that again. So it almost becomes a kind of a code within a code. And then again, you see numbers. Dice is a very common way of people to, you know, you see all sorts of different ways that people do to have that 1-3-1-2 out there. But it's and you can get arrested for it in many countries. I mean, there was a journalist in Croatia who was arrested and made to pay a fine because he tweeted ACAB. And there's, I'm pretty sure it's a criminal offence in Russia. There was a big court case in Germany for a long while. Somebody got arrested for wearing, it was either an FCKCPS, you know, front cops bag and an ACAB t-shirt. But it went to the highest court, and they then, so for a long while, it looked like it was going to be outlawed. But then they changed their mind. They ruled that it's not directed at specific policemen, so it can't be deemed hate speech. So I thought I'd get into a bit more trouble for it, or I think a bit more people would question it. But thank God it didn't. But it's got a lovely cover as well. So
yeah,
but it's been lovely. It's been really well received. Had some nice reviews but again, I feel like it's also the end of an era. I was when I was writing it, I turned 40, and it's my fourth book, and it's kind of the fourth book of you know, traveling and trying to tell stories around the world about the world, but through football and football culture. And you know, I think that's, I can't see how I'm ever going to be able to do that again, you know. And I'm sure we're going to look back at the past kind of 20 years as a kind of golden era of travel that we're going to want to desperately try to recreate, but you know, we're not going to be able to do it, I don't think.
And I mean, like, you know, as we talked about off air before, I mean, one of your other books, 31-0, which was one of my favourites, all about the American Samoan team. And that's, you know, the original film of that is going to turn into a Hollywood story. And, you know, all these things that, because of travel, because of the ability to go to American Samoa and places like that. And now, at the moment, you struggle. You can't even get a bus without a mask on. It's... I think we'll look back on this time. There'll be some nostalgia, certainly for travel, but you know, it's a strange time, and hopefully as well, you know, the stories that come out of the books that you've written and that others have written about travel and, you know, and everything, and the stories that come from that. You know, I mean, I've I've just finished reading a book about Socrates, the old Brazilian footballer.
Oh, from Andrew Downey, yeah. It's a great book.
Yeah, and it's, you know, learning about, you know, a country like Brazil, and you kind of think, I'd love to go there. Yeah, it's not going to happen anytime soon, is it? I'm not going to get to Brazil. And at the time of recording this, Brazil are probably in a worse case, in a worse state than the UK. On that happy note, James, thank you again. And I'll play out the podcast with a song that was number one at the time this film came out in the UK.
Was it PCP, Show Me Your Spine?
I think that was number two, actually. Unfortunately, the mega hit in February 1988 in the UK was I Think We're Alone Now.
That was almost as good.
Yeah, that's good. I mean, that should have been played in the nightclub, but maybe that was on next. But
maybe we have to wait for the Skinny Puppy remix of that one.
Yeah, that can be a happy hardcore one. Maybe that one's on Spotify too. But as I say, that was Robocop. James, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
This podcast was brought to you by executive producers Gary West, Fergus Higginson, Keith Foster, Jimmy Fletcher, Mark Drakes, Matt Cunnington, Christian Dees, Chris Hopkins, Omar Zambon, Ian Madrell, Katrin Lowe, Mark Makin, Zoltan Vargo, Simon Smith, Laurie Curran, Wayne McNally, Darren Hodgkins, Dan Wellington, Alex Heal, Philip Rothenberger, and Alan Fewings, and associate producer Chris Oakley. Visit patreon.com/Betamax Video Club for more information about bonus episodes, early access, discounted merchandise, and more.